Well, hey everybody, welcome to Church Online. My name's Joel, I'm one of the team here, and it's such a joy to be gathered with you wherever you find yourself for church today. We're in for a great service together. Pastor Will Green is preaching a little later. It's gonna be great. You're gonna love to hear what he has to share with us. We're gonna be taking communion together as well today. So would you note that? Grab something you can participate in communion, and we're gonna have that a little later in the service. But right now we're gonna join our team as they lead us in worship, and you don't have to have an auditorium to worship properly. You can be wherever you are. And I tell you what you do need. You need a thankful heart. And having a thankful heart will lead and open up your heart and lift your eyes to the giver of good things. It says in Psalm 100 that the Lord is good, His love endures forever, and His faithfulness continues to all generations. That's you, that's myself. For all of us, God loves you. He is for you. I want you to hold on to that promise today as you say, thank you, Jesus, and we join the team in worship right now. Here we go.
I was buried beneath my
the battle. You sing my victory. When all I see is the mountain, you see the mountain moved. And as I walk through the shadows, your love surrounds me. There's nothing to fear now, for I am saving you.
Yes, Lord.
So when I fight on my knees, with my hands lifted high. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. And every fear I lay at your feet, and I'll sing through the night. Oh, the battle belongs to you. And if you are for me, who can be against me? For Jesus, there's nothing impossible for you.
Hi church, it's a great opportunity for us to gather together now and pray. So yes. Why don't you close your eyes, engage your hearts and be with us in this moment.
Yeah.
Lord, we pray for all of the people within our church right now, Lord, that they would be growing in their faith, Lord. Mm. They'd be expanding their time with you, their yes. relationship with you, Lord. Yes, they would be Lord. Deepening their study of the Bible, whether it be in short bursts or in long periods of time.
Yep.
Lord, that they would be listening to your word, hearing your word, and actually
having their word, the word of God deepen in their heart. Lord, we pray for each and every person that their relationship with you would be growing and they would be exhorting others to grow with them, Lord. Yes. There'd be a passion in our church, passion in the people watching to see their knowledge of the scripture grow and their engagement in prayer grow. Thank you, Lord Jesus.
Yes, Lord. And thank you, Lord, that you have called us as a people to reach and build. And Father, that is such a privilege to be partnering with you in your mission to reach people and build people. And so, Father, I pray specifically into our reaching. We are all strategically positioned to reach somebody. And Father, I just pray for those relationships that you have already established in our worlds, that this week we would have opportunities, that we would have eyes to see the opportunities, that we would have conversations that are God conversations, that people's hearts would be stirred to seek after you more, Lord Jesus. We thank you so much for the privilege that it is to partner with you. And we just ask for your incredible blessing on every conversation this week. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Well, church, we've come to this time of offering together, and up on the screen you'll see the different ways that you can give, or you may have already done that. So join with us as we worship the Lord in this way. I want to read to you from Proverbs chapter 11, verse 23, from the Message translation of the Bible, and it reads, "The desires of good people lead straight to the best, but wicked ambition ends in angry frustration. The world of the generous gets larger and larger. The world of the stingy gets smaller and smaller. The one who blesses others is abundantly blessed. Those who help others are helped. Curses on those who drive a hard bargain. Blessings on all who play fair and square." I don't know about you, but I can remember at times in my journey with God that I've tried to bargain with him. And it says here in what we've just read that, you know, bargaining's probably not the best way to go when we're dealing with God. In the kingdom economy, which is where we are in this moment in our service, we're talking about the giving and the worshiping that we do with our financial resources. And I don't know about you, but I think what I've learnt from reading that is that trying to bargain with God is not a good approach at this time. It's better to be in a position where we're playing fair and equitably, and we're submitting ourselves to God, and we're not trying to, you know, coerce this situation or this time, but actually to submit our hearts, fulfilling the need to worship our King and to honour him with all that he has already given us. So rather than bargaining, God, if I do this, you'll do this, let's submit our hearts, submit our whole lives to him and worship him in the true way through our giving that is free, not coerced, and honouring him in all that we do. It's a time to be obedient. It's a time to receive what will come every day from him, because he does provide for us every day. But at this time, we honor him with our giving and say, thank you, God, for all that you have done. No bargains, just honoring in all that we do. Lord, I pray that as people give today, they would enter into this time with an open heart and, Lord, be ready to bless those around them, to be ready to honour you and to not bargain their way into the kingdom. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you for your generosity. And to participate in this moment of giving, you can head to c3churchride.com.au/give or download the church app and head to the giving tab. And in case you didn't know, there's great programs for kids and youth from preschool to primary to high school. Kids Church happens every week on-site and online. And Full House Youth runs from 7 p.m. every Friday night of the school term for those in high school.
Hi, church. We're going to have a time of communion now. So if you would like to get whatever it is you have in your house, some juice, some bread, some milk, some crackers, it doesn't matter, just something that you can participate with us in this moment. Taking a communion and taking the bread and the cup, is a time where we get to remember all that Jesus did for us. How he died on the cross, how he rose again, how because of that we have eternal life with him. We take this time as often as we can to remember his sacrifice and to thank him. There's a beautiful verse in 1 Peter chapter 2, and I want to read a little bit of it for you today in the Message translation. It says, "This is a kind of life you've been invited into, the kind of life that Christ lived. He suffered everything that came his way so that you know that it can be done. They called him every name in the book. He said nothing back. He suffered in silence. He was content to let God set things right. He used his servant body to carry our sins to the cross so we would be rid of sin and free. His wounds became your healing. You were lost sheep with no idea where you were and where you came from, and now you are named and kept for good by the shepherd of your souls." I just think that is the most incredible verse. You are named, you are kept. God knows you. Jesus died for you and he loves you so much. So as you take the bread, as you take the cup, why don't you remember his sacrifice? Remember that you are named by the shepherd of your souls, and worship him in this moment. Lord Jesus, I thank you for each person who's participating in this moment right now. I pray, Lord God, that they would know how much you love them. And I pray that they would remember your incredible sacrifice for them and be thankful. In Jesus' name, amen.
You see what's hidden under the surface. You see the beauty under the tarnish. You will find in the fire what you call gold. You will find in the fire what you can mold. Find me here in your presence. I'm not leaving the same. Let your refining fire purify me again. Let the weight of your glory bring me back to my knees. Oh God, come with revival. You can start it in me. You have a purpose, you see the outcome.
Yes, you do, Lord.
You have intention, you're bringing freedom. You will find in fire what you call gold. You will find in fire what you can. We come together with one breath, one voice, one cry. Jesus, our Savior, new hope, new life, new wine. We come together with one breath, one voice, one cry. Jesus, our Savior, new hope, new life, new wine. We come together with one breath, one voice, one cry. Jesus, our Savior, new hope, new life, new wine. We come together with one breath, one voice, one cry. Jesus, our
everyone, welcome to another message in our series entitled My Place, God's World. And we've been talking about and thinking about how we fit in God's plan. And the good news is that everyone has a place, everyone has a purpose. God has a plan for everyone in his world. And actually, before we begin, before we look at a story from the Bible, the book of Acts, we're going to actually hear from a person in our church. We're going to hear their story, a story of how where they were, you know, their place at that time, how God was able to use them. So would you just join with me as we check out this story?
Hi, my name is Jorge, and I've been coming to C3 Ryde since 2017. My wife, and she was pregnant with our second baby, and I was working in Tasmania, and we decided to have a little trip in Melbourne. She was pregnant only 24 weeks. We said, it's probably okay, you're safe to travel. And unfortunately, well, not unfortunately, but it happens that our baby was born in Melbourne, and we were not prepared for any of that. And obviously, as you're going to a hospital every day to visit the baby, you meet other families and other people around you. My wife met this lady, and her name was Prabjot, and she was a bit, you know, hesitant, and she was a bit, you know, sad because she was coming every day for almost 100 days, and she was telling my wife, look, you know, I've been coming here, and the doctors always tell me the same, he's not good to go, and she was really looking forward to take his baby home, and I was in the lunchroom looking after my daughter, and then suddenly she comes with Prabjot, and they sit down, like, this is like a lunch room, and she said, George, you have to come and pray for her. Like, I was like, oh, a little bit of a shock, because, you know, I was a Christian only for less than 2 years, and maybe I was thinking, like, you need to be, you know, well-educated, well-prepared to pray for someone. And I was like, oh, okay, I'll do my best. So I just, you know, I just put my hand on her arms and I just, thank you, Lord, for Pravja's life, and thank you, Lord, for, you know, her baby. And I pray in the name of Jesus that her baby be healed and he can go home with mom and the family, and she can be happier. And it was just like a very short prayer, and okay. And then she was, okay, thank you. And yeah, okay. That night we went to the apartment where we were staying. And I told my wife, no, we need to pray properly, because I think it was a very short prayer. I don't know. I think we need to pray more. So my wife and I, we start praying. We just sat in the lounge. While I was praying, it was a point that I couldn't pray anymore. I started crying and I was like, I couldn't speak more. So I felt in the heart, like the Holy Spirit was telling me, like, it's enough. I mean, I already heard your prayer. You don't need to make this so enlightened or, you know, very sophisticated. A couple of days later, and we heard from this lady, and she was coming laughing and so joyful in the lunchroom. Wow, I can take my baby today. And we were like, wow, I was crying of joy, and my wife as well. So it was such an experience that for us, I mean, we were looking the same, like trying to take our baby home. At the same time, we hear this, and it just enlightened our faith and our, you know, doesn't matter the length of a prayer. I mean, when you put the heart to pray for someone, and it's just so amazing when you see something like a breakthrough like this, not only helps other people, like this lady in this case, taking the baby home, but also help us to build up our faith, build up our, you know, resilience, because we were in the same boat. And they said, like, if God can do it for her, he can do it for us as well. And obviously later on, we could take our baby home. And, you know, you don't have to be fancy with a prayer. You just need to put your heart on the person that you are praying for. And I know God will listen. Doesn't matter if it's short or long, and it will happen. He will listen the prayer, and I'm sure he will deliver whatever you ask him for in a matter of days or months or years. Doesn't matter, but he listens. So never lose hope, and always put the best of your heart on the prayer.
Wow, how beautiful is that story? How inspiring. Thank you, Jorge, for sharing that. What an encouragement to all of us that God can use us, whether we feel like we're ready or not. He can do great things in us and through us, and that's just so beautiful. So we're in the middle of this series called My Place, God's World. And so today I want to take a look at a man by the name of Ananias. And, you know, he was obviously in God's world, but God had a purpose and a plan for him where he was. And, you know, God has a purpose and a plan for you wherever you are, wherever you are placed, whatever you do, or whatever your career is, or whatever your life looks like. God can move in your life and in others' lives in that place. So we're looking at the book of Acts, chapter 9. Now, prior to this story, there's a man by the name of Saul, and Saul has been persecuting Christians. He is trying to shut down the church, and he has authority to arrest any Christian he can, anyone who's a part of the Jesus movement, and arrest them. And it's his drive, it's his mission to shut this thing down. And so he's on his way to arrest Christians, and all of a sudden, on the road, there's a bright light that blinds him, and a thundering voice, and he meets Jesus. And Jesus says, Saul, it's me, Jesus, who you're persecuting. He has this powerful encounter with the Lord that leaves him blind. He has to be led away to someone's house, where I guess then he remains and just thinks about this crazy encounter with Jesus. Of course, we know that Saul will be known as Paul from now on. And God uses him in a powerful way to build the church. Many, many people come to faith in Jesus through the ministry of Paul. So much of the New Testament that we have is written by Paul. Incredible. But he was such a different guy until his encounter with Jesus. And then Jesus totally changes his life. So that's going on. And now we come to Acts chapter 9, verse 10. Meanwhile, in Damascus, there was a disciple named Ananias, and the Lord called him in a vision. Ananias, yes, Lord, he answered. The Lord told him, go to the house of Judas on Straight Street and ask for a man from Tarsus named Saul, for he is praying. In a vision, he has seen a man named Ananias come and place his hands on him to restore his sight. Lord, Ananias answered, I've heard about Saul. I've heard about this man and all the harm he's done to your holy people in Jerusalem. And he's come here with authority from the chief priests to arrest all who call on your name. But the Lord said to Ananias, go, this man is my chosen instrument to proclaim my name to the Gentiles and their kings and to the people of Israel. I will show him how much he must suffer for my name. Then Ananias went to the house and entered it. Placing his hands on Saul, he said, Brother Saul, the Lord Jesus, who appeared to you on the road as you were coming here, has sent me so that you may see again and be filled with the Holy Spirit. Immediately, something like scales fell from Saul's eyes and he could see again. He got up and was baptized, and after taking some food, he regained his strength. Wow, what a story. But Ananias was in Damascus. Now, at this point in time, the epicenter of the Jesus movement was Jerusalem. But the place we find Ananias is Damascus. Now, we don't know how he got there or how he came to believe in Jesus. Perhaps someone who had heard about Jesus in Jerusalem and been saved traveled to Damascus and shared with Ananias, and then Ananias believed in Jesus and got saved. We don't know, but we just know he was there. Not the epicenter of the Jesus movement at that time, but there he was. And any place you find yourself in is a place where God can meet you and God can move in your life. Every place is a place that the Lord can reach, that the Lord can get to. You know, when I think it's a common misconception that people have that if they had a different life or were in a different place or a different stage of life, that they would be more spiritual or they would have a stronger faith. Like, let me give you an example. My wife and I have a son and he's a beautiful little guy. He's a champion. And before he was born, I had a lot of spare time and no son. And then he was born and then I had one son and no spare time. I thought, where's all my time gone? It's disappeared. Before he was born, I had time to read the Bible and pray. I felt like I did. Had a lot of time to read the Bible and pray and serve and you know, but then he was born and I found myself really beating myself down, beating myself up, whichever direction the expression you want to choose. I was really getting down on myself about my faith. I thought, well, I don't have any spare time. I'm not reading the Bible. I'm not praying. I'm a bad Christian. I used to have all this time and now I don't. And so I thought, well, if my life was different, I would have a better faith. If I was in a different place, I would have a better faith. But then someone gave me this little devotional, this little Bible. It was called the Busy Dad's Bible. And it was just a daily Bible reader thing. And it would just have one little page each day. And so I thought, well, what's this? It's just one page. But I thought, you know what, Lord, all I've got is a little bit of time and I'm going to give it to you to read the Bible. And I can tell you that in that year, the Lord spoke to me more than maybe he ever had from the Word of God. And this is the truth, that it doesn't matter how much time or the lack of time or where you live, where you don't live, the stage of life you're in, where you're at in life, no place is too far for God to reach you. And he's just looking for an earnest heart that seeks him. And so Ananias was in Damascus, and it says, verse 10, in Damascus, there was a disciple named Ananias. The title, the designation, the identifying name we get for Ananias is not his job description. It's not his history. It's not his successes. It's not his failures. The only identifier we get for Ananias is simply disciple. Disciple. You know, before you are any other title, any other, you know, job description, above all of that, we're called to be a disciple of Jesus. And I love that that's what we get, disciple. That's what the descriptor we get of him, disciple. Because when God was choosing a person to meet Saul at this critical moment, he could have chosen one of the 12 disciples, one of the 12 apostles, back in Jerusalem. He could have chosen a prophet, could have chosen a pastor, could have chosen, you know, someone who's done incredible things. You know who he chose? Just a disciple. When my wife and I bought our car, you know, you go to the dealership and they talk through all the specs and all the things about the car. And then they talk about the base model, the entry level. It's basically the car that has nothing special. It's the lowest level and it's the basic, you know, it's like just, it has wheels and an engine. I'll take that one, you know, the base model. I love that God has just chosen in this story an entry level Christian, just a disciple. And I want to encourage you that you don't have to be the most incredible, the most amazing. You know, the church, the body of Christ, the people of God, being part of that community is not about two or three special people who do special little things and then everyone else is normal doing normal things. And we all just look on at these amazing people and we go, wow, go you, but I'm just normal and I'm going back to my normal life. No, God wants to pour out his spirit on all people and empower every disciple to serve him and to serve others. Their place in his world, their place in his plan. And so Ananias answers the Lord, the call of the Lord. He says, yes, Lord. And the Lord tells him, go to the house of Judas on Straight Street and ask for a man from Tarsus named Saul, for he is praying. In a vision, he's seen a man named Ananias come and place his hands on him to restore his sight. Often when I think about God's plan for my life, I think about things. I think about, oh, maybe God's plan is that I would do this or I would do that. But I love in this story, God's plan isn't about a what, it's about a who. It's not about a thing, it's about a person. It's about Saul. And I wonder, in your world, maybe God's plan for you right now is not necessarily about what, but it's about a who. Who is in your world? Who is in your life that you can reach out to? The Lord answers Ananias answers the Lord and he says, I've heard a lot of reports about this man and all the harm he's done to your holy people in Jerusalem. And he's come here with authority from the chief priests to arrest all who call on your name. But the Lord said to Ananias, go. This man is my chosen instrument to proclaim my name to the Gentiles and their kings and the people of Israel. This little part says so much about the grace of God. Ananias is like, hey, here's the backstory on Saul. In case you weren't aware, Lord, this is what I've heard. This is how bad he is. And God says, I know the backstory. I know the history. I know the behind the scenes and I am choosing him. And you know, for you and I, God looks at you and says the same thing. I know the backstory. I know the history. I know the sin. I know the wrong. I know the screw ups and the stuff ups and I'm choosing you. He doesn't save us because of our good works. He doesn't save us because of our perfect record. He saves us because of his mercy, because of his grace. We aren't saved by works. We're saved by grace through faith in Jesus. He saves us. And then Ananias, he follows through. He goes to the house. He lays his hands on Saul. And this is what he says. Brother Saul. Brother. He's never met Saul. He's only heard that this man would arrest him, maybe even kill him, torture him, who knows? He's heard only the bad, and yet he greets him like this, Brother Saul. Because anyone who accepts Jesus Christ as Lord is our brother and is our sister. It's so beautiful. And then he says, Jesus who appeared to you on the road as you were coming, he has sent me so that you may see again and be filled with the Holy Spirit. That God has sent me so that you may see again and be filled with the Holy Spirit. And I pray that that would be a prophetic statement over my life and your life, that you would live with this kind of purpose. Like God has sent me here to this place, to this family, to this neighborhood, to this job, to this office, to this group of friends, to this university, to this high school. God has sent me here so that you may see and be filled. Do people see Christ when they look at you? Even without you even saying anything, do they see Christ in you? Do they see Christ in your words, in your action, in your generosity, in your love? I want to pray that you and I would be filled up to such a measure that when people look at us, they would see and they would be filled. Let me just pray for you. Lord, I pray for every person right now. Fill them up. Help them see you. Help them hear you, and I pray others in their world, in their place, would experience your grace through them. In Jesus' name, amen.
Well, we've just heard a wonderful message, and we have an opportunity right now to respond to the God who is the origin of that message. In Matthew chapter 11, Jesus said this. He said, "Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest." He said, "Be a partner with me, because I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your soul." You know, a lot of people think, I wonder what God is like. The best picture you can ever have of what God is like is through the person of Jesus. And he said, "Come to me." He said to come to him and we would know real rest. Maybe you're tired from trying to be good. Maybe you're tired because of many, many burdens and worries that you've carried for a long time. Maybe you're tired because there's things that you're really regretful about, things that you just cannot loose. But Jesus says, "Come to me and I will deal with that." He says, "I'm humble and I'm gentle." And I know that to be true. Jesus is a humble Savior. He's a very gentle God. And so today you have this opportunity to respond to him, to receive him into your life, to receive his spirit, to come into your own person so that you can be born again. What a wonderful gift that is. And I'd like to lead you in a prayer right now where you can ask Jesus to come and live inside you by his spirit, and he will forgive you of your sins. He will help you to begin living a new kind of life where you will know rest in your soul. So why don't you pray this prayer with me? Jesus, I am sorry for everything that I have done that has kept you away and has hurt you. I ask your forgiveness. Would you please come and take up residence in my life? Would you lead me and give me this new life that you promise, so that I will know rest in my soul and that I can live for you? And I ask this in Jesus' name. Thank you. Amen. Well, what a great decision that is. We would love to help you as you take these first few steps in this grand new life. You could text us with a number on the screen. People are praying for you. People are really celebrating that you've made this decision. And we pray God's great blessing on your life from this day forward. Thank you.
Almighty fortress, you go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadows, you win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power. You go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadows. You win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. Oh, almighty fortress. You go before us. Nothing can stand against the power. You shine in the shadows.
Well, what a great service and what a great word from Pastor Will today. I'm so encouraged to go into my world and be an ordinary disciple of Jesus, just a run-of-the-mill person who loves Jesus and reps him wherever I am. I cheer you on in doing so this week as well. It's going to be awesome. And hold on again to the fact that God is good. His love endures forever. His faithfulness continues to all generations. You can trust him. Why don't you run into your Monday, your Tuesday, whatever day you're watching this, and knowing that God's faithfulness is for you. Have a great week. We'll see you as we gather again next weekend.